He created the universe. To him belong the heavens and the earth. The ever-living, he is the first. He's the owner of mercy. He sent his messengers to warn his creatures of the grave danger. A worshiping other than Allah. There is none greater than the Creator.
Bismillah walhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulillahi wa ba'd.
Verily, all praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Him, we seek His help, and we seek His forgiveness. We seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the evils of our own selves and from the consequences of our evil actions. Whomsoever Allah guides, walillahi alhamd, no one can misguide. And whoever is misguided, no one can guide this person except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah alone without partner. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his slave and messenger. O you who believe, have taqwa of Allah. Have fear of Allah. Be dutiful to Allah the way He deserves you to be. And do not die except that you die as a Muslim. O mankind, have taqwa of your Lord. Fear your Lord. Be conscious of your Lord. Be dutiful to your Lord, the one who created you from a single being, and from it created its mate. And from them, many men and women were created. So fear Allah, the one by whom you ask for things, and do not break the ties of kinship. For indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever over you an all-watcher. O you who believe, have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fear Allah, respect Allah, be conscious of Allah, be dutiful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا. And then say correct speech. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will amend for you your deeds, and He will forgive for you your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger indeed has achieved a great achievement. Verily, the best of speech is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran. And the best of guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The worst of matters in the religion, in this deen, are new practices in the deen. For verily, every new practice is an innovation, and every innovation is a misguidance, and every misguidance is in the hellfire. Wa na'udhu billahi min dhalika. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Welcome back, dear viewers, to another episode in this series, Live Your Life on Purpose. My dear brothers and sisters, after discussing these goals, we now have a renewed focus on our one true goal, everlasting paradise. And now that we are all determined in trying to live this purposeful life and trying to now begin striving towards this one goal, without doubt, we will all want to increase in our performance of good deeds. We will want to rectify our speech and our actions. Towards this end, we identified several characteristics that embody and describe the believer who is truly sincerely trying to live his life for his hereafter. Characteristics included honesty, piety, truthfulness. We mentioned other, maybe less obvious characteristics, reliance on Allah, having taqwa, being a remorseful slave, and many others were mentioned as well. And while all of these are praiseworthy characteristics, and each individually worthy of discussion, spending multiple episodes on, there was one characteristic that stood above them all. One characteristic that is arguably the most important characteristic that we need. And this was the characteristic of taqwa. Throughout the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is admonishing the believers and addressing the believers. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu taqullah. O you who believe, have taqwa of Allah. And we hear this throughout the Quran. So the question discussed last time, what is taqwa? Why should we all strive to embody taqwa? Why do we have an entire month, Ramadan, whose purpose is to increase in taqwa? So we need to understand what taqwa means. To start, we said that the word taqwa comes from the word waqa, which means to take a shield. Taqwa, defined Islamically, means to take a shield from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is done by following His commands and by staying away from His prohibitions. For the believing servant, the realization that taqwa serves as a shield to protect you from the fire of hell, that's pretty tremendous. This realization is huge, and it immediately opens our eyes to the importance of taqwa. Granted, we hear this word every single week during the khutbah. As the imam recites the verses of the khutbatul hajjah, we always hear ittaqillah throughout verses of the Quran. But for many of us, this word is a foreign word. It's not from our mother tongue. It is a foreign word. So we may not fully grasp the meaning of the word, and we may not fully grasp the rewards that come along for the one who has embodied this characteristic of taqwa. So start, my dear brothers and sisters, by knowing that taqwa is a shield that protects you from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is, without doubt, the most important shield that we need. And this benefit alone is reason enough to strive at increasing your taqwa. But the benefits continue. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that taqwa is a reason or is a condition for having your deeds accepted. He said, إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Verily, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only accepts from those who have taqwa. Our deeds will not be accepted unless we have taqwa. And this is huge, my dear brothers and sisters. What else? Who from amongst you has sins? All of us have sins. And who from amongst you tries to do good things to get rewards with Allah? Would you like those rewards increased or expanded? This is what taqwa does for you. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يُكَفِّرْ عَنْهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِ وَيُعْذِمْ لَهُ أَجْرًا. Whoever has taqwa with Allah, or taqwa of Allah, Allah will expiate for him, erase for him his sins, and Allah will increase for him or expand his reward. Subhanallah. Look at the benefits of taqwa, my dear brothers and sisters. So work towards increasing this. Allah Azza wa Jal will expand your reward and erase your sins. So the benefits of taqwa keep piling up and they continue. As the verse mentioned last time, who amongst us has difficulties in our lives? Who amongst us has challenges that we face, problems that we have that we don't know the answer to? Perhaps you've lost a job, or you can't find a job. The economy is struggling. Perhaps you have a bill that you can't pay. The bank account shows zero, but you owe thousands. Perhaps you have a sickness in the family and you don't know where to turn. The solution, taqwa. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَن يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Whoever has taqwa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make for this person a way out. وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. And he will provide for this person in ways that he could never have imagined. Because you don't know where to turn, but you have taqwa, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides for you in ways that you could never imagine. The solution, get taqwa, my dear brothers and sisters. Follow the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Stay away from His prohibitions, and this is the result. My dear brothers and sisters, summarizing these benefits mentioned last time. Number one, a shield to protect you from the punishment of the hellfire, from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, a condition to have your good deeds accepted. Number three, taqwa provides for you a means to have your sins erased and your reward expanded and enlarged. And number four, taqwa provides for you a way out from your difficulties. Subhanallah, my dear brothers and sisters, amazing. The characteristic of taqwa is of paramount importance. So let these rewards of taqwa, let them motivate you, my dear brothers and sisters, and let them encourage you to ingrain within yourself a desire to increase in taqwa. My dear brothers and sisters, the best way to understand taqwa is to continue doing what we've already done. Simply open up the Quran and read how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes taqwa. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا إِذَا مَسَّهُمْ طَائِفٌ مِّنَ الشَّيْطَانِ تَذَكَّرُوا فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْصِرُونَ. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, indeed, for those who have taqwa, when an impulse touches them from the shaitan, they remember. They remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then they immediately have insight. What do they remember? They remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They remember His punishment. They remember the reward of the one who has taqwa. And without doubt, this remembrance helps them to stop that evil action and to correct themselves. We continue inshallah ta'ala after a short break. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Worshiping Allah than Allah.
Alaykum wa rahmatullah. Welcome back, dear viewers. Before the break, we summarized for you the benefits mentioned of taqwa. Briefly, we said number one, that taqwa is a shield from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, we said that taqwa is a condition to have your good deeds accepted. Number three, we said that taqwa provides a means for you to have your sins expiated or erased, as well as enlarging your reward with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number four, we mentioned the verse where Allah says that the one who has taqwa, that He will give you a way out. from your difficulties. SubhanAllah, I mean, this is amazing, my dear brothers and sisters, the benefits of taqwa. But if you really want to know what taqwa means, just continue doing what we've already done. Go to the Qur'an and look where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about taqwa. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا إِذَا مَسَّهُمْ طَائِفٌ مِّنَ الشَّيْطَانِ تَذَكَّرُوا فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْصِرُونَ. Allah says, verily, those who have taqwa, when an impulse touches them from the shaytan, they remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They remember what is right and what is wrong, and then they immediately have insight. What do they remember, Allah says? Allah says, tadakkaru, they remember. They remember Allah Azza wa Jal. They remember the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they remember the reward of the one who has taqwa. And they use this remembrance to help direct them to what is right, and to help them shun the whisperings of the shaytan, and to help them stop the evil action. This is taqwa. When you are alone with a friend, and invites you to go to a dance party or to a music club, but you refrain, this is taqwa. When someone offers you some alcohol, but you refuse to drink that alcohol due to the fear of the punishment, this is taqwa. When you are driving in a car alone and you're tempted to turn up the volume and move with the beat and listen to some music, but you don't want to because you know it's wrong, this is taqwa. When someone of the opposite gender extends their hand to you or more, but you do not, and you reject their offer because you remember the fire of hell, this is taqwa. When you are in the privacy of your own home and you want to commit a sin, but you don't, fearing the punishment in the life to come, this, my dear brothers and sisters, this is taqwa. The famous companion, Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he asked another companion, Ka'b, about the meaning of taqwa. And he asked Ka'b because Ka'b was well known for his knowledge of the Qur'an and for his wisdom. In response to this question of the meaning of taqwa, Ka'b then asked Umar, may Allah be pleased with them, he asked him whether or not he had ever walked through a thorny path with his cloak on, with his outer garment around him. To which Umar responded, of course he has. And then Ka'b asked Umar to describe his movements through this path. And Umar responded by saying kind of what you saw me motion. He said that he would move this way and that way and carefully so as to avoid the thorns that could catch onto his cloak. Umar replied that he moved through this path very cautiously so as to avoid the thorns that could possibly catch onto his cloak and tear his cloak, his outer garment. Ka'b then responded to Umar and he said to him, this is the description of taqwa, being cautious with the boundaries of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being careful so as not to transgress these boundaries. My dear brothers and sisters, the definitions of taqwa are many, but none of them independently captures the meaning of taqwa. Some of them translate the taqwa, if you read the Quran in your native tongue, as the fear of Allah, which indeed it is. Some of them translate it as the consciousness, the awareness of Allah, that He's watching you, which is included in the meaning. Some translations say that taqwa is to be dutiful to Allah, which indeed it is. Others say it's the love of Allah, which indeed it is. So again, I ask you, my dear brothers and sisters, why is this so important? It is part of human nature to compete. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that we are engrossed in the competition of this dunya. Al-haakumu takathur. He says the competition of acquiring more and more and more, this competition, it diverts you. Some people compete for fancy cars. Other people compete for large houses into amass wealth. But in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, none of this matters. For the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith mentioned last time, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَى صُورِكُمْ وَأَمْوَالِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَى قُلُوبِكُمْ وَأَعْمَالِكُمْ. Verily, Allah does not look at your outward appearance, brothers and sisters, nor does He look at your money. Rather, He looks at your hearts, and He looks at your actions. The one who is closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who is more dearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the one who has the most taqwa. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Inna akramakum inda Allahi atqakum. Verily, the most honorable with Allah from amongst you is the one who has taqwa. So my dear brothers and sisters, if someone wants to know the scale by which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala measures His closeness to His servant, then know that this scale is taqwa. It's not how much wealth you have, it's not how much cars you have or how much you spent in charity, it isn't your salah, it isn't your hajj, it's not how many nights you stayed up in prayer, it's not how many days you fasted, but it's a combination of all of those good deeds done for the sake of Allah, bundled up and captured in one word, taqwa. My dear brothers and sisters, chase after this characteristic. Actively seek out the things that help you to increase your taqwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. And chase after that forgiveness from your Lord. A forgiveness prepared for who? أُعِدَّتْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. Prepared for those who have taqwa. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who are actively striving at increasing in our taqwa to attain His pleasure. Ameen. Until next time, fi amanillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
He created the universe. To Him belong the heavens and the earth. The ever-living, He is the first. He's the owner of mercy. He sent His messengers to warn His creatures of the grave dangers of worshiping other than Allah. There is none greater than the